howdy, friends, and thanks again for joining us here on Expanded Perspectives. I'm Cam Hale, and joining me, as always, it's mi amigo, Mr. Kyle Filson.
How's it going, everybody? I'm excited. I think we have an interesting show today. I'm super pumped. What about you?
I'm so happy today. I don't know what it is. I feel great. I slept good. I'm well rested. I'm ready to rock and roll. I hope everybody is having a wonderful, wonderful day. We're going to kick this day off with something interesting that actually took place down here in the Drone Star State, Philly. I don't know if you saw this. This comes from openminds.tv. The UFOs, my brother, are at it again. This down here was a Texas Sphere UFO was described as searching at ground level.
Oh, yeah, I did see this.
It says a witness, a Texas witness, at Hutto, reported watching a sphere-shaped UFO, like sphere, UFO near ground level. They said it was emitting a green light that appeared to be searching for something about 8:14 a.m. on November 22nd of this year. Now, this case number is... Now, Kyle, get your pen. Yep. All right. 72672 of the MUFON. All right, the reporting database. The witness was driving into Hutto and was close to the Vista Homes area when the incident occurred. I noticed a weird green light close to the open grass area and pulled to the side, the witness stated. It was hovering as if it was looking for something. The witness went on to describe the object's movement, saying it went side to side and then just zoomed off. This thing was very close to landing. It was just searching for something in the grass. I have never in my life seen something like this. It was silver, but the lights were green, not too far away from the grass. The witness became afraid of what she was seeing.
Yeah.
Says, I was so scared, I thought it would come close to my car. This is something I will never forget. It kept going side to side looking, and this went on for 20 or 30 seconds. And then it just turned off the light and zoomed away straight forward as fast as it could. Now, what could that be? Now, let me say this.
It doesn't tell you how big the thing was. Are we talking something the size of a basketball? The size of a Volkswagen? Like what?
When she says sphere, it makes me wonder, could it have been a drone? Could it have been somebody flying a drone close to the ground and
8:45 maybe... 8:45 in the morning hunting? Absolutely.
Just messing around? And maybe, just maybe, I'm just throwing this out there, maybe she didn't get her sizes just right. What she saw and she thought, you know, it looked spherical. Maybe it was spherical. Maybe they were just, it's a different drone.
You don't know all the drones out there. She doesn't indicate how big it was.
No, never does. I don't know. If it wasn't, if it was just, because it says a UFO sphere, without knowing the size, even an estimated size, it's wide open.
Mm-hmm.
The first thing when I read it, I'm like, maybe it was a drone. Maybe it was somebody just juking it around back and forth, playing, whatever. You know, I'm sure at distance, they could look like they were moving pretty quick if you just tilted them side to side and hovered them. And I mean, they look like they can move pretty good. I'm no drone pilot, but I don't have any idea how fast they could go. I'm assuming they could probably move pretty good side to side. Or maybe this was some funky sphere. But the way she describes it, I don't know. It's just like where those lights on it. I don't know. It sounds interesting. I wish there was a size that went to it.
Yeah, me too. Well, moving on. This comes to us from Gizmodo.com. And it talks about, there's an article over here, it's very interesting, about we still don't know what causes the knuckle cracking sound. And did you know that? It says everybody's familiar with the sounds that knuckles make when you crack them, but scientists are having a hell of a time trying to figure out what causes it. A new ultrasound imaging study offers additional clues, but still no definitive answers. They talk about how recently the first of its kind knuckle cracking study, led by radiology professor Robert Boutin of the University of California, Davis. Now, Boutin's team imaged the hands of 40 subjects as they pulled their knuckles a total of 400 times. It turns out the sound of a person's cracking his or her knuckles is often accompanied by a bright flash at the knuckle's base, a region doctors refer to as the metacarpophalangeal joint. Say that five times, Cam.
Wow, yeah, for real.
At a meeting of the Radiological Society of North America in Chicago this week, Boutin and his team argued that these metacarpal fireworks are related to the formation of gas bubbles. But whether and how those bubbles are connected to the cracks, we still don't know. Now, believe it or not, scientists have been trying to figure out what happens when joints crack since the 1940s. And two leading explanations for the pops we hear are, one, that they're caused by a formation of gas bubbles due to decreased pressure around the joints, or two, that cracking your knuckles actually causes tiny gas bubbles to bursts. Isn't that interesting?
That's strange.
It says over the years, scientific studies have accumulated evidence in support of both theories, bubble forming and bubble bursting. And to this day, the debate continues to rage. Now, it says that the latest imaging results seem to lend evidence to the bubble forming theory. He says that we're confident that the cracking sound and bright flash on an ultrasound are related to the dynamic changes in pressure associated with gas bubble formation in the joint. Right now, Cam, you're creating gas bubbles.
I can't. As I pop them all the time without even realizing I'm doing it. It's like a habit. You know what I mean? And I don't know. What's crazy to me is that they didn't know.
They still don't know what causes it.
That's simple. They're like, is it just because it's not that important to anybody? Is that what it is?
I guess.
Like, we're not going to look into that. That's really not that important.
Right? Let me see. I can crack my neck. Can you hear that?
Yeah. No, I can't do that. I don't have a neck.
That's true. That's
it's like trying to pop a turtle's neck. It doesn't work that way.
anyways, I'll put those links in the show notes. You can go to expandedperspectives.com to find those. Or if you're on your smartphone or tablet, you can just press on the Expanded Perspectives logo, and the information is in the links will all pop up. Anyways, let's take a break. After the break, Cam, you're going to be talking about the Kushtaka, and I look forward to that. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives.
All right, folks, thanks for joining us here after the break. I've got something we're going to talk about right quick that's going to be, I thought it was enjoyable. I think it's going to be enjoyable. A few weeks ago, it all runs together. Hell, I can't keep up with all of it. I'm confused. We had a guy call in, and one of our listeners, and he left us an awesome story about a Kushtaka.
Yeah, I remember that.
Remember that?
Yeah.
And it was one of those things that I'm like, man, I remember hearing a little something about it before this, but never. It's one of those things. There's always so many, I guess, names that you could say that are given to Bigfoot. So that's just what you kind of blow it off as, is it's a Bigfoot. But that's really, the more I looked into it, some of it is, I don't think that's what this is. When I say the Kushtaka. Now, there is some Bigfoot sightings, some stuff that goes along with it, but I don't think that that's what this started out to be. And that's what we're going to talk about, is what this Kushtaka really is, what the story behind that is. Because like I said, when I say Yeti, instantly you think of Bigfoot, because that's what we've been told. But what if a Yeti was something else? When I say something else, what if it was maybe not really a Bigfoot? Maybe it was more of a devolved human. And then over time, because they were also Bigfoot in that area, that they just all kind of got lumped under the same umbrella.
Yeah, I think that's very possible.
That's kind of what I believe has happened to this Kushtaka. Now, this is what I'm going to tell y'all, folks. Now, from what I can find, a Kushtaka is, I guess for any way, is kind of like a skinwalker, but without it being a person. It's a shape-shifting creature. And there are some natives in the area there of southeastern Alaska, and they're called Tlingit and Tishnamen natives, and the southeastern part of Alaska is more of like a rainforest, folks. So they tell these stories of these shapeshifters that have been in there. Now, here's what's cool. Now, if I'm going to give you the pronunciation of Kushtaka, I found some different spellings. It's like Kushtaka, Kushtak with a T. There's a loose translation of the Kushtaka, and they say it means land otter man.
Yeah, I was going to say, I've heard even some sightings where they claim it was like a giant otter man or something.
A giant otter
Bizarre. When you said, let me to back up just for a second, when you said it's in a rainforest, there are rainforests in cold areas.
Yes, yes. So
don't think that he misspoke and then he's talking about some tropical jungle.
No. Yeah. It looks exactly, it just looks, it's a cold weather rainforest.
It is a rainforest.
Yes. It's funny, though, that now they talk about, you know, this different behaviors and these different species of otter and all this as you start looking into. This is what I've come across. There's a lot of conflict when it talks about how these Kushtaka behave. Like you would think some are friendly, some are tricksters. This is what you get. They believe that they're cruel creatures, very cruel creatures, and they really get delight from tricking sailors. I said they would trick these Tlingit sailors, the native sailors in that area, by crying like a baby or screaming like a woman and get them to go out further to sea like they thought they were looking for someone to help. And I guess they either freeze to death because they get lost out there. Maybe they capsize, whatever it is.
That's interesting.
It's very strange.
I've heard of stories where, I don't remember its name now, in Japan, they have a similar story where people get called out into the ocean and drown because it sounds like a baby or something.
Something crying to them.
Yeah.
Yes. It's,
yeah.
It's very, very strange. There's also stories of these Kushtaka that tear people to shreds, like attack them and tear them into pieces. It's, like I said, they're shapeshifters. So they're tricksters. Are they demons? I don't know what they're supposed to be, but they don't come across as a Bigfoot idea. Mm. You know, it's not just like your typical hairy man. Now, there's an ancient story that, like I talked about these pronunciations there's of the Tlingit people, but there's some, like I said, I'll spell it to you. It's easier. Kush, K-O-O-S-H, Ta, T-A-Y, Ka, or Ka, K-A-W. There's also the Kush, K-O-O, S-H, Ta, T-A-A, and then Ka, K-A-A. So there's a few different pronunciations of it, but we all know they mean the same thing. And then there's the, I guess you could say Kush, because the first one I read was Kush, K-U-S-H, and then a T-A-K-A, Kushtaka. That was the very first pronunciation of the spelling that I had seen. So there's multiples on there of the same thing, basically. So I'm assuming it's probably one tribe that lives next to another tribe. They have maybe a little different, you know, pronunciation.
Yeah, when I hear Kush, I think of cigarweed.
That's what you're thinking about. Afghan is what you're thinking about.
Left-handed cigarettes.
That's right. For real,
No hate.
Yeah, no hate. Now, the Tlingit stories say that these creatures live in the deep woods or on these unoccupied islands in this heavily forested area that they say that still go uncharted, that there's little, you know, little pockets of land, these little islands and these lakes and these waterways, and that they live out there, and they're just, it's uncharted pieces of land,
it's
and
remote.
So nobody messes with them. Exactly.
It's remote
nobody
as messes hell. With them. And another thing I like is, like, how well it's accepted by the locals. I mean, it seems like everybody's like, oh, yeah, it's probably the Kushtaka.
Yeah, it's there. They fear them. There is a deep-rooted fear in these people of these Kushtaka. They don't talk about them the same way they talk about Bigfoot. That's what's really strange, is they'll talk about these mountain giants, but you start talking about these otter people, everything goes out the window. It doesn't stay the same. It seems almost like a fear sets in. Here's something else. It's believed that these creatures are excellent mimics of the animals that they live around.
Hmm.
Now, we've kind of poked before. Fun of yeah. and things. If you're going to say this or that, you kind of, this is another part of that story. That they say that the Kushtaka, when I say they were talking about the stories that the natives tell, can whistle through their teeth and make bird calls. They come off sounding like grouse and woodhens. With such accuracy, the natives say you can't tell the difference.
Hmm.
So I don't know if somebody's witnessed them doing it, what it is. But it doesn't stop there. The Kushtaka also make howls of coyotes and timber wolves with the same mastery. Now that's pretty wild.
I guess if you're in the woods all day with nothing to do.
Well, and you think about it, maybe it would help. If you thought you saw something and then hairy or whatever, and then you could mimic the sound of a wolf, you're like, oh, well, that's just a wolf, and I'm not going to go mess with a wolf. You know, instead of wanting to pursue, who knows? They talk about their ability to hunt. The Kushtaka's ability and has great success at throwing with pinpoint accuracy rocks and pine cones.
Hmm.
They use that to harvest game as well as using these little, like the small branches to make spears to stab their prey.
I never heard of that.
Now, that's pretty wild. It's also said in their tales that they're reported to be 7 foot tall and they're normal build. They're not huge, but they're hairy. So just a normal built person. Of course, I don't know what's normal about a 7 foot tall thing, a hominid, but that's kind of the idea that you get behind it. Now, like I said, they believe that they're a trickster race of land otter people. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, Mary Pelton, Jacquelle DiGennaro, actually wrote a book called The Images of People, Tlingit Myths and Legends. And in that book, this is what was written. I'm going to read this to you, this announcer. It says, the Kushtaka have been treated in some literature as a boogeyman or hobgoblin. This is inaccurate and does not honor how seriously the Tlingit people feel the threat of the Land-Otter people. In a sense, the Kushtaka deprived the victim of everlasting life, for his soul could not be reincarnated. The Land-Otter lurked to save, that is, to capture, those who drowned or who became lost in the woods. The unfortunate captives were taken by the Land-Otter people to their homes or dens and, unless rescued by a shaman, were themselves turned into Land-Otters. Kushtaka often appeared in the form of relatives or friends to confuse the victim. Dogs were protection against Land-Otter people, for not only were the animals afraid of dogs, but the dogs' barking forced the Land-Otter people to reveal themselves. Small children were thought to be the most in danger of being captured by the Land-Otter people, and were warned not to wander off from parents or venture too far away from home alone. Now, how strange is that?
Yeah.
So right off the bat, they're talking about a shaman. Only a shaman can save you. Now, you remember when we discussed the skinwalkers, we discussed about hearing some things, and I've even heard, J.C. Johnson speak about, and I've brought it up to you, that if you were going to become a skinwalker, you'd have to, kill someone close to you, you'd become a skinwalker, things like that. It sounds like if you go to live with the skinwalkers, you're going to become a skinwalker. Well, if they capture you, these Land-Otter people, they turn you into a Land-Otter person.
Yeah, that's bizarre,
that's
right?
That's very strange, isn't it?
But maybe that's a Native American's way of explaining. You hear these stories where Bigfoot would capture women and then they keep them, mm-hmm. and breed with them and mm-hmm. absorb them into their own tribe or whatever you want to call it. You know what I mean? Maybe that's so they're claiming that they turn you into an otter person.
Well, it's funny that you bring up a woman being captured. There's another story. It comes from the book Tlingit Myths and Texts by John Reed Swanton. Now, this was early and they talk about something like what you just brought up. Now, listen to this. It says several persons once went out from Sitka together, when their canoe upset and all were drowned except a man of the Kitskidai. A canoe came to this man, and he thought that it contained his friends, but they were really land otters. They started southward with him and kept going farther and farther until they had passed clear around the Queen Charlotte Islands. At every place where they stopped, they took in a female land otter. At this time, they kept a mat made out of a broad part of a piece of kelp over the man they had captured until at length they arrived at a place they called Rainy Village. At this place, the man met an aunt who had been drowned years before and had become the wife of two land otters. She was dressed in a groundhog robe. Then she said to him, "Your aunt's husbands will save you. You must come to see me this evening." When he came to see his aunt, she said, "I can't leave these people, for I have learned to think of them a great deal." Afterwards, his aunt's husbands started back with him. They did not camp until midnight. Their canoe was a skate, and as soon as they came ashore, they would turn it over on top of him, so that no matter how hard he tried to get out, he could not. In making the passage across the cape, they worked very hard, and shortly after they landed, they heard the raven. They could only go a short distance for food. When they first started back, the woman had said to her husbands, "Don't leave him where he can be captured again. Take him to a good place." So they left him close to Sitka. Then he walked around in the neighborhood of the town and made the people suffer so much every night that they could not sleep and determined to capture him. They fixed a rope in such a way as to ensnare him, but at first they were unsuccessful. Finally, however, they placed dog bones in the rope so that they would stick into his hands, dog bones being the greatest enemies of the land otters. Late that night, the land otter man tore his hands so with these bones that he sat down and began to scream, and while he was doing this, they got the rope around him and captured him. When they got him home, he was at first very wild, but they restored his reason by cutting his head with dog bones. He was probably not so far gone as most victims. Then they learned what had happened to him. After this time, however, he would always eat his meat and fish raw. Once, when he was among the halibut fishers, they wanted very much to have him eat some cooked halibut. He was a good halibut fisher, probably having learned the art from the Land-Otters, though he did not say so, and for a long time the man refused to take any, but at last consented, and the food killed him. Now, what do you think of that story, Philly?
That's crazy.
So they captured this guy. He was almost drowning. This canoe rolls up, grabs him, pulls him out of the drink. It's a canoe full of Land-Otters. They take him with him, go back, grab a few ladies along the way. Can't hate on that. Get back to camp. The dude sees an ant that he thought had drowned years before that, basically like what just happened to him. They're living with the Land-Otters. She's got two husbands. Hey, now. She's got two husbands. She gets him to take them back. The way it sounds, he's there one night. But then you read the rest of this story, it wasn't. They brought him back, but apparently he had lived there for a while with them, maybe, and had become crazy like the Land-Otters, you know, or turned into the Land-Otters. It's even wilder that dog bones, they wove like dog bones into a rope to stick in his hands, and then in order to make him come back to normal, they cut him with, that sounds like something the shamans would do. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. It sounds more like a shamanic approach.
Right.
To how to cure someone of some kind of illness or things like that. Now, like I said, this story comes from 1909. That's a wild story. I don't even know where to, you can't even dissect what even happened to this whole thing. Did somebody lose their mind and they blame it on the Land-Otter? Or did somebody really get this dude? Because, you know, that doesn't go into anymore. I didn't get into
right.
anymore.
Well,
the whole
thing. That's the problem with these old stories. But still, that's incredible. I don't know what to think of it.
Well, but it doesn't sound still like a Bigfoot. It doesn't sound like a Bigfoot group. Like, the aunt's still there living. She's like, look, I've grown accustomed to this way of life. These people are good to me. I'm going to stay here. He talks about how long he was in the canoe, and then they came back. And all. I mean, it doesn't sound like a Bigfoot abduction, like the typical Bigfoot abduction stories, if there's anything typical about them, that we've covered before. This doesn't sound like that at all.
No, it doesn't. It does sound more to me more like the this tribe are like shapeshifters or skinwalkers, and that maybe they don't have that appearance all the time. You know what I mean?
Well, you're right. And it feels like it would be a tribe of shaman.
Yeah.
You know, it's I don't know. When I start picturing these things, I think of, you know, the scariest things of all. And I don't know what it is. Like the 13th warrior. Remember the bear people?
Yeah,
the 13th
yeah.
Warrior? That's kind of the way I keep going back
the
to
thunder
in my
cliffs.
Mind. Yeah. Yeah.
Waves make thunder.
The fireworm. Yeah. That's the things I keep thinking about that. Like they thought they were bear. They thought these were demons or creatures, but they're just people. And
yeah,
that's what
you're
makes
right.
me think about this is I'm like, are they really that way? Or are they just kind of
that's a great
a
analogy.
Little, you know what I mean? Are they just a little bit more on the outside? Because that's the thing I keep thinking about. But there's another story that comes in. And this is, again, in 1900, a gold prospector named Harry Colp. And he had three friends, and they were exploring the Patterson Glacier north of Thomas Bay. Now, locally, that bay has been called the Bay of Death or Devil's Country. And, of course, that's from the Tlingits. And apparently there was a landslide in that area in 1750 that killed about 500 villagers in there. Now, that was also attributed, of course, to the Kushtaka. All right. Now, Colp wrote about his encounter, but the manuscript he penned was not discovered until after his death. After he had died. Now, he wrote all this down. And then his daughter took this. And now, like I said, this is in 1900. So this isn't something that's just a fresh one. You know what I mean? This is right. one of those things. It's been around a while. Now, this, like I said, he's been dead several years. So she actually writes this. And I'm going to read you this whole thing. And this is a long one now. There's some build up, this whole thing. I'm going to read you the whole story, folks. Y'all got it. This is something that's just really, really interesting. Says during the years, this is says dear readers, during the years the Devil's Country story had been passed along by word of mouth so often that the details had become obscured. It was then a very pleasant surprise when mother, found the manuscript just a short time ago and gave it to me to read. I found it fascinating, and I was left with a feeling of curiosity. I wonder if any of you readers will be curious. I wonder. Well, I'll just let you wonder. Sincerely, Virginia Colp, daughter of Harry D. Colp. She had wrote that at the beginning of this whenever she had it published. The spring of 1900 found four men batching together in a shack at Wrangell, Alaska. All four were broke, as is usual with prospectors. And as luck would have it, I was one of the four. For reasons which will be quite obvious, I will just call the other three John, Charlie, and Fred. Charlie came into the shack one night in April, all excited, and said, "Fellows, I've been on the trail of an old Indian for the last month, trying to get him to tell me where he picked up a piece of free gold quartz. He has it at his camp." I never said anything about it before, because I wanted to get the story from him first, and today he spilled the beans. He told me to go up to Thomas Bay and camp on Patterson River on the right side, travel upriver for about 8 miles, and then turn to the high mountains. And after traveling about a mile and a half, I would find a lake shaped like a half moon. "Plenty of stone like I found on a slide there," he said. This area, Thomas Bay, is known by the Native Americans in Alaska as the Bay of Death. About 150 years ago, a slide down one of the mountains wiped out a village, killing over 500 of the inhabitants. Well, of course, a prospector is ready to stampede on a whisper of gold any place, and we were in no exceptions to the rule. We all talked the matter over, and finally it was decided that we would run our faces for an outfit and send Charlie to look the prospect over. Well, while he was gone, John, Fred, and myself would hustle work somewhere for another grub stake and to pay off the old one. The forepart of May, Charlie loaded his outfit into a canoe and, having favorable weather, left Wrangell for Thomas Bay, which lies northwesterly about 50 miles. He had 3 months' supplies, but was to come back any time sooner if he found anything. But if he didn't show up in that time, we were to put out a search for him. John and Fred took a contract to get wood, and I got a job in the Wrangell sawmill. Things went along until the first part of June, when, on a Sunday, in the late afternoon, we all being home, in walks Charlie, without a coat or hat, and looking as if he'd been through hell. He didn't give us any greeting whatever, just heaved a piece of quartz over in a corner of the room and said, "Get me something to eat. I'm all in, and I want to rest." The fella looked like it had been a while since he had eaten. Turned in without telling us anything about his trip. We picked up the piece of quartz and say, "Boy, it sure was a pretty thing to look at for a prospector. It was shot through with gold specks, just like a badly freckled-faced kid." We were excited. I'll say we were. Just before dark, we walked down to the beach to bring Charlie's outfit, as he had come up to the shack with only that piece of quartz in his hand. But there wasn't a thing in the canoe except the oars. Not much sleep for us that night, but Charlie never stopped sawing wood. We had hard work getting Charlie up for breakfast next morning, but when he did roll out, he just ate, borrowed a coat and hat, and left the house without saying a word or even answering one question out of the many put to him by us. All of us, being excited and feeling ourselves worth a fortune, did not go to work that day, but sat around the shack, passed the blamed piece of rock back and forth to each other while we talked and waited for Charlie to come back and make his report. Believe me, we were anxious to hear it. Along in the afternoon, he came in and said, "Fellows, the SS Drago will be in on her way south early tomorrow morning. Can you give me enough money for my ticket to Seattle? I'm through with Alaska, and I never want to see it again. I'll tell you about my trip to Thomas Bay and where I found that quartz, but my advice to you is to forget about it. It will never do you any good and will only cause you a lot of mental and physical pain. If we were not partners, I would never open my lips about this trip or what I found. But if you promise to never mention my name in connection With what I tell you or mention the name of Thomas Bay to me again, I'll give you the straight on my experience up there. Judge for yourselves as to my saneness, because this is the most astounding thing you've ever heard, and as far as I'm concerned, is beyond me to reason it out. Don't ask any questions to prolong my story any longer than it takes to tell it, as I want to leave Alaska and forget it if I can. I will try to make the one telling plain enough. This is Charlie's story. The first night, after leaving Rangell, found me in Ideal Cove. Next night, I reached Muddy River in time to make camp again. The third night, I hit Ruth Island in Thomas Bay. I spent the next day looking up Patterson River for a suitable place for a good camp, which I found a quarter of a mile up from Tidewater on the right-hand side, looking up the river. Broke camp on Ruth Island the next day and moved up to a place I'd picked out the day before. Put up my tent, packed up my outfit, and left the canoe on the riverbank. The next day I spent cooking beans and cutting wood and making things comfortable for a long stay. As it looked like rain, I wanted to get these things fixed to keep dry. It started to rain that night and just kept it up for days. I lost track of time, as each day was just like the one before. Had nothing to read, was all alone, couldn't do anything without getting soaked, and the roar of the river and wind through the timber just about drove me bugs. So I put in most of my time sleeping. Finally, the weather broke and I got out. Spent several days in trying to find the old Indian's Half Moon Lake, but couldn't get it spotted. I did find, about 2 miles from camp up the river, and about a mile from it, a lake shaped like the letter S. On the creek coming out of the lower end, I panned some pretty good colors, but, as I figured, not enough to get excited about. Yet an indication of gold in the country. Talk about the dead country, now that's for sure. There doesn't seem to be any life in there at all. You might spend all day in the timber without seeing a squirrel. I was getting sort of tired of beans and rice and bacon, so I made up my mind I would go over to a ridge about 8 miles east of the S Lake and get a few grouse, as I thought I could hear a few hooters up there when I was at the head of this lake. I left come the next morning, which was a fine sunny day. I took only the rifle with me, and when I came to the ridge, sure enough, there were a few grouse hooting. I shot two and gotten them when I bagged another one, which fell down the ridge about 100 yards before it hung up. While on my way down to pick it up, I found that piece of quartz. Up to that time, I had paid very little attention to what the country was and what it looked like, as it was so heavily timbered and brushy. The formation didn't show up, and I had no tools with me to uncover it. The top of an old snag had broken off and fallen, scraping the top moss and loose dirt for a space about 8 feet wide and 18 or 20 feet long, uncovering this quartz ledge, which is where I found this piece. This ledge was worked smooth by a glacier at one time. I couldn't find anything to break off a piece with, so I used the butt of my gun to get that piece, and in doing so, I broke the stock of my gun, thus ruining it for further use. This didn't worry me any, as I knew there was not game in the country larger than a grouse, and damn few of them. My first thought was of the richness of the quartz and of you fellas, and getting back to town to round you all up so we could go get busy on it. After looking over and enjoying the feeling of knowing I had made a rich find, I covered the ledge up again with moss and limbs and rotten chunk. Finishing that job, I thought I'd climb the ridge directly over the ledge and get my landmarks, so I could come back to it again, or tell you where it was if anything should happen to me. And this I did, climbing straight up and over the ledge on the ridge till I reached the top, which was about 600 foot above where I found the ledge. I looked down below me and picked out a big tree with a bushy top, taller than the rest and about 50 feet to the right of the ledge. Looking over the top from this tree, from where I stood, I could see out on Frederick Sound, Cape of Straits Light, the point of Vanderput Spit. And turning a little to the left, I could see Kodiak Island from the mouth of the Wrangell Narrows. Satisfied with that, I turned half around to get back sight on some mountain peaks, and lined below me, On the other side of the ridge from the ledge was the Half Moon Lake the Indian had told me about. Right there, fellows, I got the scare of my life. I hope to God I never see or go through the likes of it again. Swarming up the ridge towards me from the lake were the most hideous creatures. I couldn't call them anything but devils, as they were neither men nor monkeys, yet looked like both. They were entirely sexless, their bodies covered with long, coarse hair, except where the scabs and running sores had replaced it. Each one seemed to be reaching out for me and striving to be the first to get me. The air was full of their cries, and the stench from their sores and bodies made me faint. I forgot my broken gun, and I tried to use it on the first ones. And then I threw it at them and turned and ran. God, how I did run. I could feel their hot breath on my back. Their long, claw-like fingers scraped my back. The smell from their streaming, stinking bodies made me sick, while the noises they made, yelling, screaming, and breathing, drove me mad. Reason left me. How I reached the canoe or how I hung onto that piece of quartz is a mystery to me. When I came to, it was night, and I was lying in the bottom of my canoe drifting between Thomas Bay and Sequoia Island, cold and hungry and crazy for a drink of water. But only to satisfy the latter urge, I started for Wrangell, and here I am. You no doubt think I'm either crazy or lying, and all I can say is, there's the quartz. Never let me hear the name of Thomas Bay again, and for God's sakes, help me get away tomorrow on that boat. So passed out Charlie from our lives. We put his story down as fantasy, caused by loneliness and morbid thought. What the hell happened to that fella, Philly?
I don't know. That's a crazy story.
He comes back.
Well, and you, before you start, I mean, yeah. While I'm listening to your story, I'm kind of looking on Google Maps, like where this Thomas Bay is.
Yeah.
And you're not going to believe the listener that called in. Thomas Bay is like right next to Petersburg, Alaska, where he
really?
Claimed he's from. Yeah, it's right here. It's right
there
here
you
next
go.
To Frederick Sound. Thomas Bay is just north of that. I mean, just north of it.
The thing that gets me is it's not like the dude showed up and made this stuff up to say, don't go back there. And we're never going back. And then he went on and did something else. And then he went back on his own.
Yeah.
That seems like an unless. Because I thought of this. When I read the whole, you know, I thought of this. He's telling him he wants to leave. Help me pay. Here's the thing. But why wouldn't he just leave and not tell him where it was at? But he pretty much tells him exactly where he went.
Oh, you think he made up the story so that they wouldn't go and search
well,
him and go back later?
I thought that there was a thing of, yeah, that I'm like, I'm going to make up this story and tell him where I went and all this stuff. But he'd already told him everything. As far as, you know, you got to go to this S Lake. And he told him all that before he went there. And then he went there and he came back. And he's like, dude, don't go. Here's the quartz. He left them with the quartz. He just left it there. He didn't want to go back. So I'm like, well, maybe that's not really what went down.
It sounds more like those were really his friends and he was giving them a warning.
It doesn't.
He just didn't want anything to happen to him. Because he knows that they know where this supposed slide
yes.
is. Where this,
yes.
This golden quartz and everything. But he came back to purpose and say, look, don't go, man. I'm telling you. Don't go.
Yeah, it's exactly, you're exactly right. He did all that, so he's like, guys, if you go, it's funny to me, is what he's talking about, is like he's running to get away from them. They're chasing him. He didn't know it. Now that he turns around and he sees them. And it doesn't sound like a Bigfoot sighting. When he starts talking about sores, you know, and it's
but
just...
But he does talk about how they look half monkey, half man almost.
But how else would you explain anything
right,
like
yeah.
that's running, a hairy running thing at you moving like a man? Instantly, you think of a primate.
Yeah, I guess, man.
But is it a shapeshifter, though? That's what I'm getting at, is maybe this isn't a whole Bigfoot thing. Because he's talking about, you know, their long clawed fingers, their sores, this whole thing. They're sexless. You can't see their sex organs, is what I'm saying. I don't know. Every time you see an otter laying on his back cracking shells, you don't see his junk floating up there. Maybe they keep it all hidden up. You know what I'm saying? An otter man. I don't know. It just freaks me out. And then the story that he called in from Petersburg, dude, you're in the hot spot for this stuff.
Yeah. That's
There's something going. Look, we already know that Alaska gets tons of sightings. of strange things.
Well, and also when I was looking at Alaska, where this is, and people, everybody in their mind can picture what the state of Alaska looks like. This is way south. I mean, like, it's really more like British Columbia than it is Alaska.
Yeah, we're not talking about being way up, buried up in the snow and all that stuff. That's really not what we're talking about when you think of Alaska. We're not, you know, life below zero or something. We're not talking about that part of Alaska.
Yeah,
we're talking about the BC part of Alaska, which is like a rainforest. It's, I don't know what it is, man. This is one of those things that's really got me thinking, because I'm like, is this just misidentification as far as the Kushtaka really is a Bigfoot, some sort of primate?
Yeah.
Or was there a different people? Was there a different group of them that lived out? Because like I said, you think about those people from the 13th Warrior. That's what this sounds like. It sounds like a group of people that moved out there on their own and, you know, go and steal people. Oh, you know, and this is the way it all ends up. It's just, it's a creepy old school stories, and I love them. I love the old school stories like that.
I know, and we run into this problem all the time. Every time, because it's an old story, for me, it just seems more incredible, right?
Well, it seems more believable, and I don't know why that is.
I know, I'm the same way. But
I'm a sucker for it.
Maybe it is a group of people. You know, they're just different looking, or they're maybe not, they may not be Homo sapiens, say. And they do have a small pocket, and they know that through interbreeding, because of the small size of their tribe or whatever, that
it's causing.
If you can get an outsider, no, let's get them and start breeding with them to kind of get rid of disease and sickness and deformities or whatever.
Well, and let's say a group of people left their village or left their tribe, and they wanted to be out on their own and be away from what it was. And what better way to do some pretty sinister stuff to try to get that out there is those aren't real people. Those are like Land-Otter people, and you don't want to, you know, there's so many things that run through my mind when I think of this, because the instant I think of when you start talking about otter, I start trying to link it to water. Is it because they do something with water? You know, maybe it's the way their boats looked. Maybe it was the way they dressed. I mean, I don't know. There's just so many things that run through my mind, because it does not sound like a Bigfoot. I don't know. It doesn't. And maybe it is. Maybe this is a pocket of, like, they say that we have three-toed Bigfoot in Texas.
And in Louisiana, too.
Exactly.
Right?
Maybe that's what it is. Maybe this is just an offshoot of the Bigfoot population that they have up there, of the cryptid population up there.
Why not?
I'm going to have to go with something like that. That or it's some skinwalkers. Either way, man, it is scary. I can't imagine being chased by something like that.
Do you think, like you were saying with the 13th Warrior, the reference there?
Yeah.
That it could be actual humans, and they wear some kind of costume that they make from like otter pelts or something, and then create the mythos of this otter man,
the shamans,
just because they don't want anybody up there. You know, who knows?
It could very well be, because the reason I say that is because a lot of the stories now, you don't find a lot of the stories that talk about these land otter people with, you know, oozing sores and stuff. You find more of it along the Bigfoot connection.
Mm.
So were they there before and they've all died off? That's no longer a thing, and Bigfoot's taken over. Or were they misconstrued, or were they just people putting that out there as to keep them out away from there? One of my favorite parts of all those stories together is they're talking about a coat made of groundhogs.
Yeah.
That'd be a lot of groundhogs to make a coat out of me.
Yeah, right.
You know what I'm saying? I need a bunch of groundhogs for me. I mean, you take a bunch, because I've seen them, and they ain't big
enough.
Maybe
they're bigger up there.
I'd hope so.
You know, the ones in Texas aren't that big.
Yeah, I'll eat one of them, too. Maybe they're good eating up there in Alaska. Good Alaskan groundhog grubbing. I don't know. Those are the stories that I found, because this is one of those elusive stories of hominids. We've talked about a ton of these crypto stories.
Yeah.
And some of them you can go on for months about the same subject.
Man.
And then some, it's just like the Jamaican that we talked about, the dog faced or the man faced dog.
Yeah.
You get these pockets of stories, and then that's where it ends. And that's kind of the way this thing is with this Kushtaka, is you don't really seem to get. Now, look. I've been on a ton of websites already. I've got some sightings here in front of me right now that have happened within the last, you know, 8 to 10 years, all the way up till present in Alaska, of large hairy hominid sightings. Driving down the road, people seeing them in the creeks, all this. Nothing goes out there like this, what they're calling these Kushtaka. I can't find one like it.
That's pretty cool. Everybody should look into it for themselves. I'll put links to some of those books in the show notes. Let's take a break. You're listening to Expanded Perspectives.
Hey guys, what's going on? First of all, let me just get right down to it. I got a pretty good story about the shadow people encounter I had. And I'd like to say you guys' show is amazing. Love it. You guys do an awesome job. I kind of new to podcasts. Started listening to them around all this Halloween here. And, one of the podcasts, different one than this, I can't remember the name of it, but has a show about the shadow people. And I just about lost it. I couldn't believe that somebody else was having these dreams. Or whatever you want to call them. Like me. But from Mount Vernon, Indiana. I just know small town farmer truck driver. I was just going to bed like any other night. Went to sleep and was having a dream. But then it didn't feel like a dream no more. I was walking out to my living room. And my dad was on the couch. And I looked outside towards the patio and there was a tornado. I just reached out, like going in my room, you know, in my dream or whatever. But then I got this sense that something kneeled or laid, sit down on the edge of my bed. And in that instance, I woke up, but I was couldn't move, hands to the side, blanket all the way up to my face. And I was just stunned. And I seen three shadow figures at the edge of my bed with red glowing eyes, but the red eyes were like a film, like a cat, you know, when you shine in like on a light at night and you see that red film on an animal's eyes. Oh, scary as hell. Scary as all get up. And then a shadow, that tornado figure, I don't know, came into the room, but it was tall, hooded, and had red eyes. They were all just standing there, and when I would try to move, I started to shake rapidly. My whole bed was shaking, and I would try to close my eyes, and I just felt like I could still see them. They were still right there, just breathing. This terrible feeling. I mean, hell, it's hard for me to explain it right now. I mean, but and it, I finally started to move my feet and turn over, and you know, rolled up. Got underneath my covers like that's going to do anything. And then they were gone. And it, oh, it was so scary. Then, I, you know, I told a couple people, and they just brushed off as a bad dream. So did I. I didn't really put too much thought into it. And about, oh, a couple months later, I was out with a buddy of mine. I don't really talk too much. And I was telling him about it. And he about lost it. He said he had not three shadow figures. I had four all together in my room. Talking about clear. But he had the tall hooded shadow figure with cane, maybe even the top hat. I don't know. It might be Hat Man. I don't know. But he said it was right under the edge of his bed. He couldn't move. And the shock, just like I was. And I was like, this is crazy. Crazy. Myself, I think shadow people are the greys. I think they're the aliens, you know. I think the greys run with this tall other dude, I've heard. But I've done a little research, not much. But I just wanted to kind of give you my story. And hope you like it. And thanks again for hearing me out. If you guys hear it, I love the show. And keep doing what you're doing. All right, you guys have a good week.
And we're back with Expanded Perspectives. What a crazy story. I love the encounters with shadow people, right?
Oh, I hate them. I love to hear about them, read about them, but I can't handle that, man.
Thank you very much, Mr. Homegrown 42069. We really appreciate you passing that story on to us and letting us use it during our breaks. Incredible. He doesn't know if he saw a Hat Man, you know. He thinks it's the grays that are invading his room. It's totally creepy no matter what.
Yeah, Completely.
I hope everybody enjoyed that. I hope everybody enjoyed the tales of the Kushtaka, and I hope everybody goes out there and investigates, you know, it for themselves. Get on the internet. Search up some stories. Buy some of these books. Research. Tell us what you think. Very, very interesting. If you would like to share a story with Expanded Perspectives, just like Mr. Homegrown 42069 did, you can always call us 817-945-3828, or you can go to our website. It looks different now. We've been having it worked on, and it's not 100% finished, but it looks much better, expandedperspectives.com. You can email us a story if you don't feel like telling it to us. You can go to expandedperspectives@yahoo.com. You can send it there. And me and Cam, we try to read everything we get now. We can't promise that if you send us a story that we're going to play it. But we do enjoy hearing them. And I've got a ton more that I've got saved. And I listen to those sometimes. It gives me new ideas for the show. It's really interesting just to hear people's encounters.
Yes.
And I enjoy it. Because these aren't accounts that are on the internet. These are just individuals that, you know, they're listening to us. Or they listen to a segment we do. And they're like, you know what? I'm going to call Cam and Kyle. And I'm going to tell them what I saw. And I find that probably one of the most interesting things about doing a podcast is getting to hear the stories from the listeners.
Well, and just interacting with listeners and things like that. We get so many emails and messages and stuff. I try to get to them all. Me and Kyle are trying. We're still trying. It just, we get slammed. But that's it, is I love the stories. I love, and it's fun, just like he talked about that he had found. There's so many things that people may not know. Like, you're not alone. You're not alone in your ideas. You're not alone in maybe your experiences or in what you think. It's fun to know that you're like, this didn't just happen to me, or I didn't just see this. I'm not going crazy. I didn't just imagine this. There's hundreds of other people that have had these experiences, you know? So I'm like, it's one of those good things. And it's good for everybody to know that, you know, you're not alone. And just about everything you do, somebody's been there or before you or has experienced something like that. So.
Yeah, well, for people that are not elite members, we recently did a show called Missing Treasures of the Third Reich, and on that episode, we talked about these two treasure hunters in Poland that think they found a buried train car filled with Nazi gold.
Mm-hmm.
And we're talking it's going to be worth billions of dollars if it's in fact there. And a listener just sent me an update on that story about how Poland expects to know more about this rumored Nazi ghost train this month, and it's talking about in this article that by mid-December, we should know if there really is gold buried in that train. Now, to bring you up to speed, if you're not an elite member and aren't familiar with the story, like I said, there was two men, and they think they discovered this lost train that's filled with gold. But they went to the Polish government and said, hey, look, we need permission to dig this thing. Do we have permission? And the government was like, no, we can't grant this unless you tell us where it's at. And the guys were like, wait a minute, we're not going to tell you where it's at. And they weren't even greedy. They said, look, if you'll let us keep 10%, of the total amount found, we'll tell you where it's at. And the government still doesn't want to grant them access. So they've been at a stalemate for months. But it looks like now the Polish government somehow has figured out where it is, and they're using ground-penetrating radar. And it looks like they've reached some kind of agreement with the two gentlemen, and they're looking to figure out what's in it.
I think what it is like you just said, I think that maybe those guys, they weren't forthcoming with enough information because they didn't want the guys to go, oh, well, let us take a look first, like they did. I think they finally came out with a little bit more and said, look, here's what we found. We can guarantee you there's something there. And I think they went to showing, because if you look at some of the photographs that they've posted online, you can tell there's something there.
Oh, yeah, they say.
And this ain't the only one. They're talking like there's going to be more that they're going to be finding, but they believe that this one is the first of many that they're going to locate.
Well, these two men that found this treasure, these aren't just amateurs, okay? I mean, I know that they're amateur treasure hunters, but they're not amateurs. One of the guys is a specialist at detecting things under the ground.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he has experience, and he says that they have irrefutable proof that there's something down there. Now, of course, the Polish government is saying that they're not giving these men access to it because it could hold dangerous things, like it could have, you know, deadly gas stored or unexploded bombs or mines, and, you know, they don't want it to be a risk.
And see, I don't believe that.
I don't either.
The reason being is because why would you hide that? You'd be using that to defend yourself, and you're in a war. I think they were hiding something that they really want in there. That, or it's just a bunch of nonsense.
Right?
You're going to open up, it's just going to be a bunch of like trash. You'd be like, oh.
Well, and there's more to the story and other stories of missing Nazi treasures, but you have to be an elite member to enjoy that. If now's your chance, you can go to the website. You can sign up to Elite, and you can go back and listen to that, because apparently there's all types of missing treasure over there.
Mm-hmm.
When the end of World War II started happening, the Nazis knew that they were going to lose, and so they just started stashing gold and stuff everywhere. Jewels.
Yeah.
Jewels that they had stolen, you know, as they swept across Europe. Anyways, Cam, what do you got planned for this week?
I don't. I'm just We're trying to knock some more stuff out. We're working on trying to get the videos out that we want to get. We've been monkeying around. We've been telling everybody we're going to do a monthly wrap-up. It's still coming, but right now may not be the best time for
December
it.
December is a really hard month.
We may have to wait till after the first of the year. I put one out in January is probably what we may do. That's what we may do is put one out at the start of January, something like that. This is just too much. It's piling on us and everything. We're trying to get everything done at our jobs by the end of the year and then get all this stuff done. And that's it. So we're working on the videos and just working on stuff like that right now. So
that you almost had to do the show by yourself. I was on the roof hanging Christmas lights and I almost fell off.
I would have recorded you while you was on
the. What am I, an iron lung?
Yeah, you got that breathing tube. I would so like you to be trached. That'd have been hilarious. You'd have to hold it over.
Can I get like a speaking spell, like Dr. Stephen Hawking?
Yeah, yeah.
Just give my thoughts.
Kyle doesn't believe he's really thinks of the guy. They're just programming.
You're hooked up to a computer. If you're hooked up to a computer, you have access to Google. Doesn't mean you're smart.
That's right. We're gonna do. Oh, that's what you need to do for your dad. You need to pretend that your dad can do all that. You know how awesome that would be?
That would be.
We could just type it up. It would sound like he was doing all. Can we put a speaker on your dad? And then we can type it up and it talk and it'll say what we want it to say, but he has to wear it so you can get him. You know what I mean? You know how mad he would get? We're doing it.
Well, I hope everybody has a good week. Like we said last week, get your Christmas shopping done. Don't procrastinate. It'll be here before you know it. Everybody be safe. Everybody don't work too hard. Get the jobs done. You know you're going to be taking off and slacking off around the holiday.
Eat what you want, folks. Eat what you want. Fill yourself up with greasy, cheesy fun.
Well, yeah, because when New Year's comes, you know, you can start your new resolution.
And for 2 weeks, you can work out like crazy and then never go back to the gym again. Yeah. That's what I like to do.
Everybody take care. I'm Kyle Filson. He's Cam Hale. This is Expanded Perspectives.
Peace!